So, I thought people might find this interesting if anybody's ever kept aquariums before. I don't think it's still where I can see it. I see this anemone's eating right now. And what it's eating is flake food. About four flakes landed in it. I've been trying to decide on a feeding method to avoid overflow, turning off my overflow box here. Okay. And as you can see, it's off now. It's because a whole lot of it went to the surface. And I need to rearrange my power strips to where I can just turn off my pumps without turning off my lights. But this pergola, she eats a lot of air bubbles trying to catch food. So I was trying to get the food off the surface, and I thought, while I'm at it, I'm gonna go ahead and do what I've always done and use chopsticks. I don't even use a matching set anymore. I don't know what happened to my matching set. Mismatched set of chopsticks. So I couldn't get that good of a grip. But I used the chopsticks and kind of flicked the food down there to the anemone. Flicking the camera with my hand like I would flip the chopsticks. So use your brain and figure that one out. But it would've been better if I could have turned that pump off there. Put my cigarette out. Shit. Well. So. This little guy consumed at least five different large pieces of flake food and didn't let any of them go. I mean, ate them all right up. But I'm not going to feed the tank again to show how it looks. If you see an anemone, you know how it freaking eats. And I'm sure you've seen an anemone grab brine shrimp or something. But I've never used this before. This is Ocean Nutrition, made in Thailand. Oh, this is made in USA. What? Mom said, my wife said, my mom, Jesus Christ. My wife, not that lifetime, this lifetime, my wife, the large, so my wife said it was made in Thailand or something. It was made in USA. Gourmet food for all tropical fish, yes. Alright, feeding instructions. Doesn't say nothing about chopsticks. Ain't that something? I'll call him and tell him. So, it's called Prime Reef Flakes. And I didn't want to use the Omega with garlic anymore, and that was the only one they had in flakes. And they didn't have my preference, which is, of course, a, guess what, Hagen product. Hagen lights, Hagen filter, Hagen ballot, Hagen pumps. Alright. So this is the one that I used to use. And it basically, this stuff looked exactly the same. Smelled exactly the same. Same kind of reddish blend. I'll let you look at it. Because I actually have this food is in this container now. Because, well, Hagen. That's good for feeding fish the normal way. But I like to grind up my flake food first with the chopsticks, holding the container very steadily with the hand that is now holding the camera, so I can't show you, but you go back and forth and kind of mix it around and grind it up at the bottom, right? And you get it nice and fine. I mean, the finer the better. Fish like small food, you know, especially plankton feeders. Okay. And oh look, I just got these guys all full of freaking food because I, you know, was distracted filming, didn't think for a second, oh yeah, they're wet, because I just had them in the tank like a dumbass. So I guess I'm gonna try chopsticks. See, they're not supposed to be full of food. You're supposed to try to grab the food in between the chopsticks. Hopefully I'll make some of it down there. I don't know if I grabbed any or not. Oh yeah. Problem is the flake food matches the anemone. There's something right there. I'm just gonna bring that right in. And see what you can do to get your flake food off the surface of the water when using chopsticks is when you take it up, you know, when you're not filming a video and you can remember to do this and the appropriate time where the food's all in one place. Just take your chopsticks and stir water. So there he is, closing up around the piece of flake food that he got. We're trying to close up so he can bring that forward. And the best thing about an anemone that takes flake food is the flake food is actually mixed. It's balanced nutrition. You don't have to worry about a different type of food for it. If it'll eat flake food, you're, as the natives say, shitting in tall cotton. Yes. So, I wish I could hold this camera. I'm going to hold the camera with my teeth.
Okay. So I guess I should stop narrating. But I'm taking a light and putting it over. I don't have a real canopy yet.
I don't have the right size bulb, so I definitely need both hands to put that freaking thing back and pull the bulbs up into the positions like I have them. You always want your actinic in front and your white light in the back, so your low light and blue light corals can be displayed in the front. Down at the bottom. And then anything that likes a lot of light. Well, that one doesn't really like a lot of light. Those guys like a decent amount of light. They can get the light from the back. And the anemone. Pigging out, man. Stretching out for more. Oh. Can't do nothing about that, because it's a good thing those fish were really hungry from catching air bubbles. And I've been trying to hold off in large part on feeding the tank because of the sick fish, maroon, staring at me, telling me to do something. Why don't you go back there and play with your friend? Look, he's sick. Look, the poor guy's sick. Poor girl. Excuse me. Yeah, so this is about 6 hours after I filmed the last video, and not much has changed. I think the maroon's hungry, so I better turn the... give them, give the
operculas a little while longer to eat, because there's still plenty of food on the surface. So I'm going to turn the pump back on and let the clownfish have a go at got caught while it was still dripping just a little bit back there. I let the maroon clown. Let Bob the Tomato clown. Bob the Tomato. excuse me, sorry. Oh, look at you swimming over by the current. Are you feeling better? This is new. Oh, wait. I'm a dumbass. The current is off. But, I mean, she's exploring. Aren't you helping her stay up right now? You are hungry, aren't you? Alright, I'm gonna turn the pump back on down here. Alright, so this is not how your power strip should be. I'm playing a dangerous game here. And I've put these boxes kind of wedged between a shelf and the ballast to prevent water from easily dropping down there. Okay, so I guess now we're going to see if the maroon clownfish eats. Oh, I just saw a couple more bits of flake food drop into the bubble tip anemone. I think shitting and talk out over here. Oh, I think a spider just dropped in my bath. That's good. They do that around here. Just, you know, a spider drops from the ceiling from time to time. Live out in the country and you got freaking screwed together roofing panels and a fucking movable prefab house that isn't on a basement. I mean, they take, like, what, you know, would be a prefab house up north on a basement. And they just put it up on fucking skirts like a trailer here. And they call it a trailer. But, I mean, it's I've seen trailers. This is a little nicer than a trailer. Not much, because it's fucking 30, 40 years old, but, man. It's definitely bigger than any apartment I live in. And hell, I get to paint and cut the grass. Most people wouldn't look at having to cut the grass as a good thing. But I have fun. Got a riding lawnmower. I almost want to say she's looking a little more healthy, as still unhealthy as she looks. And she is kind of just bobbing back and forth like she's lost a little bit of her bladder control, you know. Not like a pee-pee bladder, like the buoyancy bladder, and that's usually a sign that a fish is on its way out. Oh, Jesus. And there I go being a dumbass again. Helps to take that off if you expect the food to make it down to the bottom fucking tank. Okay. Let's see if the maroon notices. Oh, yeah. She's eating little tiny bits. That's why I grind it up, because she was actually struggling eating the large pieces. Or he. Sorry. It's kind of backwards, isn't it? So yeah, as you can see, you grind that flake food up, and anything that eats zooplankton is going to be tearing that shit up. corals. I've fed flake foods to zoo anthids, zinnia polyps, had them just growing like crazy. I don't like you twitching around like that. Are you getting sick too now? I get a closer look at the camera than I can without bending over right at the tank. Come on, you can't focus on a fish. Fish is focusing on me. Alright, let me see that side right there behind your gill, man. I can't remember, is that just the way the clownfish looks? She got some kind of infection happening on her fins from brushing up against a guy for so long. How did you move away when I just zoomed the camera in? That's a stupid coincidence. Be something, huh? Well, this one should be. Ooh. That one should be healthy enough to survive an infection. Considering that I'm already about to be doing baths. Look at this one, just swam through the freaking current. Go you. You're not actually eating, are you? So general immune disorder from harsh treatment while traveling is basically what happened to this fish. She had ick, which is taken care of. She had intestinal parasites, which were taken care of. Or at least she shed a lot of them out after breathing in a bunch of fresh water. But this is fin rot. Fin rot will usually require a copper treatment. I'm sure the kids these days have some kind of advanced stuff that I haven't heard about yet, because I'm an old school Aquarius. But what we used to do was just take a old cup or a bucket, something like that, empty container right there. Drop your little fish in there, and then put the recommended dosage of copper in there, which is usually just a matter of a couple drops. And then let it sit before netting the fish back out of there. Or you just pour the fish into the net over the toilet. Don't miss. I hope you don't wind up in the toilet, little girl. See, the maroon loves you again now that he's had something to eat. That's usually how it is. Man. So cute, he cheered her up a little for a second. Oh. That sand is right where I usually cycle the water back and forth between this tank and my 10 gallon here. Because obviously 10 gallon isn't enough water volume for any kind of decent life, but you can actually take advantage of this as a refugium, because basically this won't break down ammonia and nitrite very well, but it will break down nitrate very well. Note the algae, okay? And of course the chlorpa. So you can take your water from here that's got low nitrates, put it in here. Take your water from here that has high ammonia and nitrite, and put it in here where the rocks will take care of it. And the high flow and everything. And as long as you don't have buildup of fish food, and that's what narcillaris snails are for. Narcillaris snails might be the single most invaluable piece of cleanup crew other than astrea snails. If you got narcillaris snails and astrea snails, you're in good shape. But if you want to really have the best possible cleanup crew guy, it's a helmet head snail. And if you know where to get some, let me know, because I want some now. Well, if your water conditions are just right, and I've had them just right in a standalone 10 gallon with a skimmer. Okay, no skimmer on here, right? I've had them in this tank, actually, before I turned it into my sump and then turned it back into a tank. And those little guys, I saw one breed one time, came up on the side of the rock, shot eggs and sperm, and I saw, like, some other clouds of eggs and sperm come out of the rocks. I didn't really know what was going on. I knew I had a few of those helmet head snails. And then, about a week later, suddenly I had about 500 of them. Little tiny, 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 tiny ones on the glass. And I wound up, some of them were black, some of them were white, and they all just kind of immediately grew purple coralline algae on their shells. So, I mean, just the cutest. They have these flat, like a half a clam shell for a shell. And they have a face kind of like an astrea snail and a body like an narcillaris snail, and they can get around quick. And I mean, they're funny and they're cute, and I just don't know how to explain how cool they are. But if you have a shit ton of them in your tank, oh, your tank is a clean place. So, they're called helmet head snails. I used to call them cowries because I didn't know what the hell they were. It kind of reminded me of, like, I don't know. what a calorie should be called, because calorie is too cute of a name for what a calorie is. I think most calories are murdering sons of bitches. Anyway. They're predatory snails, like cone snails. Usually, I think. I didn't have cowries. I had helmet head snails, so I was going off a childhood memory there. So, could be wrong. Could have been misinformed. Just saying. I'm aware of these things. Yeah. Oh man, are you gonna survive? Are you going to survive? Shake your head yes. Yes, I'm going to live. Cause my boyfriend takes good care of me. Yeah. So the plan is up here, if this bubble tip does well, I'm going to try to get a slightly larger one to put near it. I don't want a bunch of bubble. I mean, I don't want like a very big bubble tip or a bunch of anemones in this tank. But I do want a few small ones. And I know the small ones are going to grow into big ones, but you know, that happens. And, well, with bubble tips, they say you can apparently, fluctuate the salinity. I don't know what they call fluctuating. But, if you raise and lower the salinity every few weeks, you can cause them to split up. So you'll wind up with multiple small anemones. And nobody knows why they do that, but I find it very interesting. And I want my happy couple to stay a happy couple. Because the longer they go without an anemone, the further apart they seem to swim. And I don't know if that's going to affect their breeding. I've never had a mated pair that actually bred. Didn't have them long enough. I had to move here and give them back. For all I know, these are children of my last pair. For all I know. But I don't think so. But, like I said, I think these are from two different pods. Because this one's darker orange. Like a brighter, more vivid orange, and that one's got the more yellow color, right? They're both Indonesians, but that one looks more Indonesian. And it's not really showing up on camera, but I mean, those are, those are both some really nice colored clownfish. The yellow one isn't nearly as yellow as it looks right now, or the yellower one. And she is bright. Real-time tangerine glowing orange. She is awesome. Why do you have a nick on your fin? Oh, if this one fucking fish gets these two sick, I'm gonna be about the same. I'm gonna have a hard time not beating the shit out of the guy who sold that fucking acellaris to my wife. You don't sell a fish that's been in your fucking tank for a couple of days, okay? You don't move a fish within 2 weeks, okay? If you have a fish that just come into your store, you hold that thing for at least 4 days. At least 4 days. You'd be kind of a prick and taking a risk. You know, you'd have to tell people that it's only been 3 days, if it's only been 3 days. And I'm guessing that this one's probably the three-dayer. Probably was there the night before. Now we bought it on a Sunday, probably came in Friday. Friday night, maybe. Because you can tell she's stressed from moving. I didn't do a harsh introduction for her. She wasn't blowing around in the bag. Okay, she was on this side in her bag. And I use my salinity meter. Okay. I use my salinity meter. And I just pour a little bit of water in. Every couple of minutes. Until the bag gets too full. And then I let some water out. And then I kind of let it open to the tank so I can see the salinity change and see if there's a difference in salinity. And if there's a big difference, I'll put it back up. If there's no difference, I'll let the bag hang open in the water and let the fish come out on their own, which she did. And she was swimming around the bottom of the bag, active. Then after she got in this tank, same tank that these guys, which are more sensitive, are doing fine in. Just a few hours went by, and she's got that travel shock. Too many different salinity changes. So, I mean, a fish can be acclimated and then, you know, change its system. And then, like, it slowly starts to recover. You know, and it takes a fish a couple of days. And if they're still acclimating to that one system, and then you put them in another system, their hormones, their glands, whatever controls osmosis, okay, the intake and excretion of water through the skin to control their body pressure, it gets stressed out. Their immune disease, their immune system tries to compensate for it, tries to heal stuff that isn't broken, and then it becomes weak. And then the fish gets all infected. And because its salinity, ability to adapt to salinity is all messed up and being targeted by her immune system now, she's having trouble maintaining balance. Get off the ground, you'll get infected. Good tomato. The maroon's clown's name is Tomato. I'm gonna skip the Bob. Yeah. I mean, well, he is a he, right? It's Bob. Bob the tomato. It's not a tomato clown, it's just, he's a tomato. He's an actual tomato. Look at him. That wasn't very funny, was it? But I'm not a clownfish, so I don't tell jokes. Wait, no. Ah. Go take care of your lady over there. Come on, go take care of her. Run to her for protection. There you go. Realize, oh yeah, I need to take care of her. Now. Come on, let's get you some air. So if this is the only video you're watching, yes, this is my refugium. Don't mind the clear floor. The plants are floating. We get some more for over here. But right now, poor little baby chick. Okay, sorry, I drifted. Okay, now I gotta edit this freaking video. I just spaced off thinking about this freaking tank setup that my friend Rick told me I could pay him later for. Really? Why are you gonna do that to me, Rick? 3 30-gallons. One on top of the other. Already drilled. Already drilled in the back. Yeah, drilled in the back, not the bottom. You don't want to drill glass on the bottom. It compromises the strength of the glass. But, which Rick, you know, reminded me, or taught me, and I remembered. Yeah. Thinking of Rick has reminded me, yeah. Okay. Sorry, I'm just kind of babbling, so I pay attention to what the hell I'm doing while documenting this possibly dying fish and a maroon clown trying to cohabitate with her. So yeah, I think I'm about to get a little bit of fresh, clean sand. Some micro-grade rated sand, or actually Petco brand sand that I bought for that little freshwater plant tank. Area to keep her from getting reinfected with whatever got shat out earlier. So I'm basically going to polish this turd of a situation by trying to slap some paint on it in the form of some fresh, clean sand. Hopefully I won't stress her out too much doing that, and I can keep her from getting infected. Maybe she can rest on the bottom safely for a few seconds at a time. The maroon is not being nearly as attentive as he was before. I don't know whether he's given up on her or whether she's actually feeling better at all. And he doesn't feel the need to make her have to pick the ick off. Like maybe all the ick is gone, so he's not picking it off anymore. Or maybe it's just because I'm over here and he's just been staring at me the whole time. Okay, he's not being aggressive towards her. She keeps going right back to this clean sand. So, yeah, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to put some cleaner sand in there for her. And, yep, that's it. Thanks for watching, everybody. I'll post another update soon. And keep in mind, this is going to be probably a day delayed. I gotta get that done. I gotta get some other work done. So, thanks for watching. Like and subscribe. Peace.